everybody. How's it going? Ziegler here with Couch Nerds, and I'm joined with...
Dylan.
And this is episode 3 of Critic and the Casual. And this one, we're going to be doing Stranger Things Season 2. And unfortunately, Ricardo couldn't be here to put in his 2 cents. If you need to know why, just, let's just say episode 8 hit him a little personally.
Tug on my heartstrings right somewhere, why don't you?
But that being said, Stranger Things Season 2, we finally finished binge-watching it, and oh my god. What a fantastic series.
And, man, like, there are just so many more things to talk about with this season than there was Season 1. Like, when Season 1, like, started and we watched it all together, well, watched it majority together, I had a lot to say, but at the same time, like, it basically left me full enough. Season 2, for the quick synopsis, is just generally like, this is taking place a year after what happened to Will in Season 1. Mike is mourning over the fact that he's distraught and, like, just, like...
Yeah, he's still feeling the loss of Eleven.
He's upset by it.
Yeah, to the point that he's, like, tried calling her on the walkie, like, every day for, I think it was 352 days was the last time they show it on the episode. Yeah,
no, it was 358, I think. And, life just kind of has continued on. Of course, Winona Ryder's character, being Joyce Byers, is still... She's not babying Will, but she's being very, like... She's hovering over him. She's being one of those mothers that hovers over him.
Very careful and very watchful.
Exactly. So she'll pick him up for early from school to go to the doctors. She'll take him anywhere he wants to go. So she's literally being one of those mothers who hover over the child, but for a good reason. Like she's literally like afraid that, you know, something else might happen.
Yeah. And speaking of Will, you would think that his life would get better once people found out that he wasn't dead. But instead, they, like, treat him like crap because of the fact that they thought he was dead and then he came back. So now they just call him Zombie Boy and make fun of him all the time.
Ha ha, you came back from the dead and stopped making your brother and parents worry about you. Ha ha. I'm like, are you serious? Kids in the 80s are dicks. They could make fun of you for anything.
Yeah. Did you die? Did you die? Did you, like, die?
Did you cry before you died? Wah, I'm gonna die.
Big baby. You don't see me dying and crying and cry dying. But, like everybody in the school, there's, like, multiple times he's walking through the school and everybody's
staring at him.
And everybody's giving him the straight-up fucking Episode 1 Naruto treatment.
Oh, fucking, like, he's got, like, the nine tails in him?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, that's not almost entirely wrong.
Well, it didn't happen yet.
He just shoots out a big Bijou bomb at the end. Ah! Fucking blows up the school. But no, so it's like, that's Will's thing. And everyone's having their own kind of like, I guess that's what I mean by like...
Everybody's having their own character arc.
It really is. Like, there's so many side stories happening in this season. More so than the previous one.
Yeah.
Because you have things going on with Steve and Nancy, but then things happening with Steve and Jonathan. Then you have things happening with Will and the group, but then also Will is going on with his own separate thing. Lucas and Dustin are meeting this new cast member
Max.
Max. Her name is Max, and it's Sadie.
I fucking said that.
Well, I know, but I'm saying, like, Sadie Sink is her name. Like, Sandy Sink is the actress's name. And... I really liked her. I really genuinely liked her. Like, I thought when, like, you know, she was first introduced and I heard they were adding a new cast member to the actual kids group, I was like, huh, I wonder how this is going to play out with, like, them adding another character. Because, like, you had such chemistry with Mike, Dustin, and Lucas.
I was going to say Mike, Dustin, and Justin.
They had such good chemistry in the first season.
It's funny, because when I first saw her, I thought she was going to be a love triangle with Mike and Eleven, and then it ended up being a love triangle with Lucas and Dustin.
Yeah, Dustin and him were like corn dogs for this shit, because she was good at video games, could skateboard, and she, like, fucking, like, was very observant. Oh my god, how fast she, like, noticed that these guys are stalking her. Well, in her own words, stalking her.
Even though I wouldn't say it was completely a love triangle,
yeah,
but it was a pseudo triangle where the first couple of episodes it looked like she was working more towards Dustin, and then after that Dustin went off with Steve
exactly,
and Lucas. It was pretty much Lucas' time to shine.
You're not wrong with the light triangle with Eleven and with Max, because you saw how Eleven was reacting when Max was with Mike.
Yeah, but that was a placebo love triangle. It was only there because Eleven saw it out of context.
Well, even so, at the end, whenever Eleven's there and she sees Max, and Max is being very kind of introducing herself, is like, "Hey, I've heard a lot about you. You sound really cool." She's like, "Fuck you, bitch." And you were my man, and she doesn't shoulder bump her, but she does one of those small glide on her shoulder.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's gonna be more tinted towards season 3. You're gonna finally get Eleven have confrontation with Max.
I was gonna say there's either gonna be confrontation or she's gonna start easing up around Max once she sees that she's dating Lucas by the end of the series. Eleven's very, and not trying to go Eleven's after
Eleven's very
Mike.
Hard to see him, very hard to understand emotion.
Yeah.
So, she probably won't get that right away. But I love Max, and I love Lucas in this season, too. Lucas, in the first season, like I was saying in our original review, felt like an anchor point. He was always going to be meant to be this character to get upset, get angry, and then, walk off from the rest of the group.
Yeah, granted, he did cause a lot of drama for the group, but almost every time he caused drama, admit it was pretty justified.
No, he was in the right. I agree. He was in the right. But that's what I was saying. From the beginning, I felt like that from Lucas' character.
And but even though he was starting drama, there was also plenty of times where he was spearheading what they needed to do.
Yeah.
He was the one who did not want to stray from the path at all. In fact, I think the only person who wanted that more was Dustin, because he had to break up the fights and get them back together.
And he actually had nothing sidetracking him the entire first season. He had nothing he was there to be that character. He had nothing holding him back or basically saying let's give Dustin his own little side plot too. No, he was always a part of the group. Anytime you saw Mike or Lucas, Dustin was there. I was getting upset because I feel like in Lucas's case in season 1, he was justified for thinking the way he was thinking.
Yeah.
And this season, I didn't feel like Mike was. He was just getting upset to me to feel like he was getting upset. Yeah, he's got a lot of emotional baggage thinking that Eleven's gone, but still thinking that she's somewhere out there and pawning over that idea. But any time Max would speak to him immediately, she's like, "Hi, my name is Max. Fuck you!" You know?
Yeah. To be fair, he wasn't, the worst. Granted, his character did not do much in this season, but, at the very least, he was there for Will. Once he got to Will's house, he pretty much stuck with him the entire season.
And that's what I'm talking about, how this, focuses so many
everybody,
on other
Everybody had their own thing to do. Mike was sticking with Will, and Will was having his own shit happen with the Mind Flayer, as it was called, thanks to Dustin.
Looked like fucking Cthulhu.
Yeah, and then Dustin was doing his own thing with Steve. Lucas was doing his own thing with Max. Nancy was doing her own thing with Jonathan.
And then
Eleven was doing her own thing with Hopper, and then just doing her own thing in general. And Hopper was doing pretty much, he was doing the most. He was going everywhere. He had to keep Eleven hidden so she wouldn't get caught. He had to make sure Will was okay and help get him to his therapy sessions with Dr. Owens, who is the new doctor head at Hawkins Labs.
I love Dr. Owens.
Yeah, it took so long for us to decide that he was a good person.
No, when he was first introduced, I thought he was just another asshole doctor.
Yeah, he was Miss Will's mom. You can trust me.
Exactly.
And we were just like,
"You're evil.
I don't think I can trust you."
Yeah, I don't think you can trust you at all. And then
this show gave us so much cynicism that we thought that Bob was secretly working for Hawkins Labs.
Bob, the nicest character.
It ended up he was just a really cool guy. He was just a really cool guy who you don't call Bob the Brain for nothing.
He figured out so much shit with nothing. They gave him nothing to work with,
That discount Patton Oswalt looking fuck was the MacGyver of that show.
He was amazing, and I was so upset. So upset. I'm not sure if we put a spoiler warning already. I'm pretty sure we did. Did we?
Well, if we didn't say it outright, we would have put a spoiler warning at the very beginning of when the podcast started.
Okay, well, I'll put one in the beginning, and I probably put one right here again, just so you know. Basically, my favorite character from season two, Bob, dies in the dumbest way possible. So, not to give too much away with the scene, but essentially, more of those rabid dogs, like, get broken out into this, like, fucking facility where Dr. Owens works.
Well, quick, in context, at the beginning of the season, like, end of episode two, beginning of episode three, Dustin finds a little lizard slug thing that you find out later was the slug that Will threw up into the sink at the end of season one.
It took it forever to fucking regrow.
Speaking of which, it took a year to get that big, and then it took 3 days to grow legs, and then it took 8 hours. 8 hours to grow to the size of an average dog and eat Dustin's cat.
It was like a slug when, like, fucking Will threw it up.
But anyway, so it grows to the size of a full-grown dog, and then later you find out that there is more. Like, probably 2 to 3 dozen more, at least.
Where the fuck were they hiding?
Tunnels.
Right, yeah.
Pretty much, now going back to Bob. So, a series of unfortunate events, more than likely just decided from the creator, because I don't think Bob is this stupid to do all this shit wrong
sequence. Honestly, I literally thought the direction, like, when they were writing this shit out, and Bob was reading it on the script, and, like, when he was acting out, he was like, okay, Bob walks away and leaves the gun there. He pauses, he's like, looks at the director, he's like, what? He's like, you leave the gun there.
But why? Because you don't have any gun experience. You wouldn't remember to grab a gun that you're not used to holding.
He stares at him.
Fine, enough.
And he's like, yeah, fair enough.
My character seems to be pretty fast on his feet based on everything else that's happened
this year. Gets to the broom closet scene. Okay, now you gotta knock the broom out. But that'll attract the dogs. Exactly.
It's to add tension. Okay.
Broom gets knocked down. Starts running. Makes it through the door. Okay, now when you see Winona Ryder's character, you're going to pause for a hard minute and look at her.
Hard 4 seconds.
Yeah, and look at her and be like, I'm home. There's a dog right there!
Shouldn't I, like, run out the door like a bitch?
No, this is not the
time for you to puss out.
It's to indicate that you're happy to see her and that you're excited to be with her after this whole ordeal.
Yeah, and so you're ready to spend the rest of your lives together, and then... But I literally see right here, dog attacks Bob!
Eats Bob! No, it's okay!
It's a fake out! We're gonna bring you back in season 5!
It's a typo! Typo for what?! Dog hugs Bob.
With what? With his claws and his weird
face hugger face mouth.
That face mouth has like spike teeth. It's a very aggressive hug.
And the actor is like so nice. He's like saying, you know what? Fine. I'm pretty sure no one would like Bob at all.
Yeah, I'll just make him really dorky and wholesome, like a 50s dad, but in the 80s. Nobody likes 50s people in the 80s anymore.
Yeah, I'll try to be nice.
I'll call myself Bob the Brain.
I'll try to be an actual dad to Will.
Yeah,
I'll give him
bad advice, like telling him to face his fear and just stand still and yell at it instead of just continuously running away.
Okay, I'll give you that. Like, really,
but only because I don't know that it's actually a real thing, because I think it's a dream because they're not allowed to tell me anything. That'll make me unlikable, right? Yeah, perfect. Good, then let's do this. Time to be the most unlikable character ever. Dies. Rip Bob goes on Twitter with 23,000 fucking tweets.
Did he really?
Oh, I wouldn't be surprised. Heshed.
By the way, Bob's character is essentially like, he's Winona Ryder's new love interest.
Yeah, Bob was definitely my number 3. Number 1 as far as new characters, number 3 as far as characters in general, and we'll get to my number 4 soon. Because that character was not there that much. But, like, the 2 episodes he was really involved, he was a hoot.
Oh, okay. Well, we're just going to it. So, like, remember how we were talking about how Nancy and Jonathan were doing their own thing? So, Nancy's being very, like, affected by Bob's death now more than ever.
Yeah.
Because, like, she just had dinner with Bob's folks, with Steve.
They weren't allowed to know that Barbara got killed in the Upside Down world.
So, she's currently
missing, and they're looking for her.
And they're really upset. They're literally about to sell their house to pay a detective so he can work full-time on Barb's case. And Ziegler brought up a good point to me when that was happening. He literally looked at me and just said, like, wait a minute. Didn't they make a fake body that looked exactly like Will's and they convinced everyone that he was dead? I'm like, yeah. Why didn't they just do that for Barb? And I just kind of stared at him. I'm like, That's a damn good point. Why didn't they do that for Barb? Like, they just left this big looming plot hole, like, Barb's dead.
Where is Barbara? She could be anywhere.
Ooh. Like, you guys made this whole elaborate thing of making a dead body, putting it in the lake.
Yeah,
near
you
the
did
area
it in, like, 36 hours, which shouldn't even be plausible unless, like, well, I'm not even going to go into that, but it doesn't seem like you could even do it that fast, but still. You had a whole year to fucking make a fake Barbara.
And you did nothing.
Yeah, you're like, I guess we'll never find her. Everywhere but at the parents.
Oh dear, I had a whole year to do this. All I got left is a box. A cardboard box. And
So they find
you
out
just freak me out whenever you like you just have silent moments when I try making a joke. It really makes me feel like my jokes aren't hitting anywhere.
It's okay. That's why we add laugh track.
Fuck you.
So they find out where this detective lives, and they go all the way over there, her and Jonathan, because in episode 2 or 3, her and Steve have this falling out because she's so mad at the fact that she can't tell Barbara's parents about this shit.
Like, she takes it out on Steve.
Yeah, that she takes it out on Steve and gets super drunk and pretty much shit-talks him the entire night.
And basically says, I don't love you. I'm like, ow!
Yeah. No one ever wants to fucking hear that unless they actually don't care. But,
and she has the biggest pushed out moment with him.
So, so she starts clicking more with Jonathan again because Steve has him drive her back to her house and put her in bed and shit. And then, like, they try to do this whole elaborate thing where they're gonna tell Barb's mom about what happened to her.
No,
and
I think that was part of the plan from the beginning. Like, actually, like, making
to get captured?
To get fake captured.
Oh, okay. And then, so they get captured by Hawkins Labs people, and they're told about the importance about not telling Barbara's parents about what happened and all this secret government conspiracy crap. And somehow, super, like, uptight, don't want any secrets to get out government conspiracy people, don't take her purse away from her that's secretly hiding a videotape recorder that's recording the whole conversation.
I'm not sure if I was just completely oblivious to, like, the shit that was happening in season one, but season two, I brought myself up a couple of notches. I noticed so many different stupid-ass small plot holes to this series that I was like, wait. So, you guys were elaborate enough to, like, make it so Jonathan's car couldn't start, surround the car, but not make it conspicuous enough that people would, like, be in a panic, be like, why are those four guys surrounding this car with two kids in them? And bring them here. But you weren't like, ma'am, can we check your bag, please? What's this, a tape recorder? Smash! No, they're like, this way. Sit down. We're gonna say everything about why I don't think it's a good thing to tell the parents why Barb's dead. Bye.
Yeah, and it Place sucks because the person who talked to them about it was Dr. Owens, and Dr. Owens ended up being a cool guy. Anyway, going back to Nancy and Jonathan, because we kind of derailed a little bit. So they get this stuff recorded, and they're like, I know the one person who can help us expose these fucks for the frauds they are. And they find his address, and they go, and they open up the door, and it's my main man,
Paul Giamatti.
Yeah, pretty much discount Paul Giamatti.
This actor looks so much taller than Paul Giamatti.
He's like Paul Giamatti if Paul Giamatti wasn't fat.
And short.
But he still was balding.
That's very true. He was still balding. The character's name is, like, Murray.
Oh, yeah, Murray. I was trying to remember his name. I couldn't remember if it was
the
Murray or
the actor who actually played him, fuck, this site sucks. Brennett Glenman. Brett Glenman.
He was awesome.
No, he was...
Murray was awesome. He had, like, some of the most comedic timed fucking talking points, but, he had probably my favorite line in the show.
To give you some context for that, essentially is, like, Jonathan and Nancy are having, like, the whole feelings rekindled in there, like,
The downplayed sexual tension where they don't want to be together, but secretly they do, and, like, he totally, like, psychology therapies them to figure,
oh,
like,
he goes
in, like,
in on
half
them.
A minute.
He goes
figures,
in
like,
on
their
them.
Entire secret out.
Yeah.
And he's like, and
that's,
then he's like, I'm
secret,
gonna just sleep.
Like,
can I just sleep on your pullout couch? Yeah, sure. So he goes to sleep there. She goes to sleep there. They cross paths with each other once, and they're like,
No, yeah, fuck that guy trying to fucking, like, you know, tell us how we are.
He doesn't know us. He doesn't know our story. We're not going to get together or nothing. Yeah, totally, John. It's time to go our separate ways again. Yeah. They go back. She's like, fuck it, he was right. She goes to open the door, and he's already there.
With his pants off and everything.
Well, we don't know that. But he totally...
His rigid nipples.
Oh, yeah. His fucking perpetually hard nipples.
No, like, me and Ziegler had to rewatch that scene 3 times because we were so distracted by the actor who played Jonathan Byers. His nipples were just, like, so hardly protruding out of their shirt.
He's like, I've been waiting for this scene to happen since episode 1, season 1.
My boner than my nipples. Like, they were just so fucking... pointed. Anyways, so
they start making out. They go into her room. The door closes, and then later on, it goes to the next morning, and they're eating breakfast.
This motherfucker cooks some eggs, and he's got waffles and shit. Like he's this guy's awesome.
The cleanest joke in the entire episode.
It's straight up silent for like a minute. No one's talking. Nancy and Jonathan just have giving each other small glances. He knows what's up.
And then this happens.
So. Jonathan, how was the pullout?
I'm sorry?
The sofa.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it was good.
I bet. Oops.
And it was the most hilarious fucking time thing ever.
I love when that scene happened. Jonathan's like, what? No! And Nancy's like, just giving that smile. She's like, yes.
She's like... yeah, he gave me the good dick last
night. Oh, she loved it. Like, you can tell
like,
her character
loved
it.
No, I totally didn't. My pull-out game is strong. She's like, not when I'm around.
No, literally, Lancey looked like she loved it. From that point on, anytime Jonathan was, like, near her, she'd have this big, like, shit-eating grin, like, that man fucked the shit out of me.
Yeah, he did to my pussy.
Like, no, Jonathan must have a really big dick or something.
No, I was gonna say, she was thinking to herself, man, Steven did to me, or not Steven, fucking, Jonathan. John did to me what he did to fucking Steve's face in, like, episode 6 of season 1.
Pounded it.
Beat the shit out of it.
But, oh my god, dude, that scene was, like, the introduction of that character, like I said, fell off of me, but, like, when they were there, and the three of them were having chemistry...
He was such a good character. I really hope when season 3 comes out that he actually plays another... He continues in that
series. I feel
like
he will. Like I said, I feel like a lot of these characters are gonna, of course, get reintroduced. They're not done by any means.
Well, except for Bob.
Shut up.
But we already talked about Nax. Now let's talk about her older brother, Billy, or as I like to call him, a mix between... young Heath Ledger and the main leader of the vampire squad in The Lost Boys. And tell me if you cannot fucking see that. Like, we'll put a picture of it with the Lost Boys leader with young Heath Ledger's face on it. Now you can't unsee it, I'm telling you. You're not going to be able to unsee it.
This character's name is Billy.
This guy was a grade A++ asshole.
He literally was a piece of shit. I hated him. He had zero redeeming qualities for me. Like, they introduced why he was such a big piece. Because, like, he's been a piece of shit throughout the entire movie. Like, he doesn't consider Max a sister, even though, like, his dad married her mom. So, like, they're stepbrother and sister now. But... he blames her for almost everything that's going on. Why they're there in Hopkins. Like, just everything. Like, why the parents, I guess, are even together. Like, he absolutely hates her.
He hates her. He hates all her friends. He hates pretty much everyone at the school.
Yeah, he literally said that all the girls are cows. He says Hopkins smells like... it's not even that, the fact that he's making fun of Hopkins or the people there, but... the moment he met Steve, he didn't even meet Steve. He just heard rumors about this guy named Steve who used to be like the coolest guy around and like how docile he is now. And he's like, oh, really? I'm gonna fuck with him. Every chance he gets, he fucks with Steve for no other reason but just to be like, I'm the alpha dog now. Even though you stepped down, I still want to prove myself to you because you were the previous alpha dog. And that's how I roll. I'm hard. I hated him.
Yeah.
Zero redeeming qualities. And when you find out why he was kind of such a big... like, I guess you don't even find out why he's a big piece of shit. You feel like what kind of influences him to be a big piece of shit. I'm still like... you're still a really big piece of shit.
Yeah.
I don't care how much of a backstory you
like. His dad backstory. Is clearly abusive, but. And, like, that's pretty much how all bullies work. They get bullied by someone else, so they treat everyone else like shit. But it still didn't fucking help.
No, it didn't help at all. Like I was telling Ziegler when he was facing him, like, this guy could have the most tragic backstory ever. He could have watched both his parents burn, and now he's trying to take care of Maxine just because they asked him to. I could care less. You do not treat a little girl like this.
Yeah.
She was so fearful of her life sometimes, because, like... He almost ran over fucking Dustin, Lucas, and Mike. Only because she was pissing him off. Like, this character is just unbelievably a piece of shit. And I'm not sure if, like, they tried, or they intentionally wrote this character to be this big pile of steaming trash. Or if, like, they're gonna make him a little bit better in season three. But in Steve's case, Steve still had a lot of charisma in season one going for him. He was so nice to Nancy. He was so sweet to Nancy.
Yeah, and he treated John like shit, but at the time, like, everybody thought he was, like, this creepo, stalky dude.
And not just that, he was
like, secretly a serial killer.
And he wasn't even upset about that. He was more upset the fact that, like, fucking, like, Jonathan took pictures of him and Nancy, right? So he got upset about that. Then fucking, he got upset because he thought Nancy was being with Jonathan. So he kind of had reasons to be upset.
Yeah.
But he was never outwardly
douchey. And then he got humbled. And then he got likable. And now he's, like, one of the best people in the series.
He never actually, like, showed, like, in that sense, an alpha dominance to Jonathan.
I mean, hell, even though he pretty much knows there's something going on between John and Nancy during the entire time they're gone.
He tells him to be together. He essentially tells him.
Well, not just that. Well, I think he's saying that, like... Man, fuck you. You just broke my heart. Fuck you. I'm sure you like Jonathan. Just go be with him. Asshole. And then, like, the entire time, he starts bonding with Dustin, like, little brother, big brother
thing. That's amazing. I love some of the characters. They just, like, bonded together.
He slowly just integrates himself out of the relationship and just, like,
he really,
becomes okay with it.
He really, like, I'm not saying he, like, was, like, kind of, like, I'm not saying he wasn't mellow before, but he really, really mellowed out near the end.
Yeah.
Like, he just...
And even though he's mellowed out, it doesn't mean he doesn't still have the fucking cat-like reflexes.
No,
like, one of the biggest heart stoppers in the season was when he goes to confront Dart, and four other dogs show up.
I'm gonna show this scene to you guys, because it's so fucking amazing. Like, he goes out there to try to draw Dart out so they can fucking get ready to fucking light his bitch ass on fire, and, like... You see two other quick figures of shadow come to the right of him. And then you just hear Lucas like...
Get out! 3 o'clock!
Busy here! No! 3 o'clock! And you see two more of those fuckers. He's like, shit! Look to the left of him. There's another one like, hey, how's it going, buddy? Shit!
This is like that scene from Jurassic Park. I'm so fucked!
Oh, wait, no. I'm a main character.
Yeah, I'm one of the main cast and crew right now.
He fucking takes off and
he jukes. He bobs and jukes and vibes and fucking rolls across a car hood and dodges one. And then another one jumps at him and just smashes him in the fucking face.
The quickest reflex.
And I'm just like, the whole time, just like, get to the bus.
Me and Ziggy were so afraid that as soon as he was going to get to the bus, a magical fifth one was going to appear and just go... And like,
yeah, he's gonna get bobbed at the last second.
No, fucking, like, Steve had such a badass moment there, and then into
Billy. And then one of the two disappointments in the series for me, the fact that
we all know Steve really can't fight without that bat. Like, come on, like, Steve is a scrawny motherfucker. He's the size of Pete. Like,
so, like,
there's in his punch.
He drew a good amount of blood.
You can still draw blood when you keep repeatedly hitting the same sweet spot, but, like, you saw how fucking he was tanking those hits out. Motherfucker was psychotic laughing.
He needed this. He was the one who got laid out in the last season and got humbled, and then he got laid out in this season instead of humbling the bully by laying his ass out.
Remember when I was telling you in season one how Byers was, like, a heavier weight class than Steve? So it made sense why he got bodied. Billy's a 3-time heavyweight champion versus someone just coming into the rookie league.
We watch anime. This shit happens all the time for us.
Yeah. In anime! This is Stranger Things!
Yeah, I've seen Stranger Things! They could have fucking done this! You get fucking... I can't say you get power-ups, because it's not a fucking anime, but when you're drawn into a fucking corner, and you're in that rage mode to go in on someone, you fucking... I don't know. Once you start getting...
Adrenaline.
Yeah, the adrenaline. He got the first four hits in. He should have been able to follow that up. But no, he gets hit with a plate once. The fucker hits him with a plate.
Have you been hit with a plate in that like, right there? That shit hurts.
I'm not saying it doesn't, but you're literally telling me how he outclasses him in all these ways, and he hits him with a fucking plate like a fucking pussy?
That's because Billy's a bitch. I told you this. Billy's a bitch.
I don't care, Dylan. He needed this. He fucking needed this. I needed this. He was my favorite character. No wonder we had a fucking fight.
But no, like, I guess we're coming to that point, and I guess I know you had a problem with this. I definitely had a problem with this. But like, so
I didn't have a problem with this too much.
Season two added an extra episode. Season one had 8. This one has 9.
I wonder if this was an added episode or if this was planned the whole time.
I feel like it was planned the whole time. But the reason why is because at episode 6, there's a big cliffhanger moment. That me and Ziegler actually had to pause to go walk my dogs. And then when we came back, we were so excited to watch.
Alright, it's time. These dogs are about to fucking go in. It's time. It's time. And all of a sudden...
Your previous scheduled program has been canceled. Please be informed with this latest episode of...
11 Goes to Chicago.
It's an entire 11 episode, which again, 11 side story.
I enjoyed all the story. I enjoyed 11 storyline, and I didn't not like this episode. I liked it, but they put it at the worst possible time. 11 so leaves. She goes to look for where this girl might be, and she finds her, and she was shown in episode 1 for like the first 2 minutes, to the point where when I saw this part of the video, I was like, Dylan, are you sure you put on Stranger Things and it wasn't like one of those glitches where you accidentally put on like one of those superhero origin series and it just had Stranger Things description on it for some reason?
No, I was like, no, I'm pretty sure this is not like X-Men Defenders, and I actually backed out. I'm like, yeah, see, Stranger Things too, and huh. We're back to it.
And I was like, alright, we'll let this play for like 5 more minutes, and I swear to God, if it doesn't say the word Stranger Things in the title, we're fucking figuring this out.
As soon as we saw the numbers on our hand, we were like, oh yeah, this is definitely Stranger Things. And then like when they're introduced, oh my God. Sorry.
She finds where she is, and she goes all the way to Chicago.
It was Pennsylvania.
I think it was Pennsylvania at the beginning. I could have sworn she went to Chicago this time.
I don't know.
I might be wrong. It's either Pennsylvania or Chicago.
Discount
one of the two.
New York.
Yeah, I guess. And she eventually finds her and her friends, known as the C Team.
If you, or someone you know, is secretly a telekinetic who is dangerous and being hunted by the government and may be trying to fight against their oppressors, you can call them if you can find them. They are the C-Minus Team.
Honestly, they had almost no character. One was just soft, one was crazy, one was serious, and the other one was just an asshole. So, like, that, you could literally, like I'm sure they're a good group together, but they didn't show as much.
And then they were led by their fearless leader, the Great Khali.
The Great Khali?
Now I need you to take Khali from the show and Photoshop
you're
wrestler the Great Khali's face over her.
A lot of me. But no, like, so Khali is another like experiment, experimented child. Her actual second
supposedly the only other one, because she was the only other
one
shown
in
the room.
I'm sure
there has
others.
To be. Her number was 8, and 11's number is 11. Speaking of which, at this point, you find out that 11's real name is Jane, which. Not only did the show give off some X-Men vibes, but seriously, you're a girl, you're a telepath, and your name is Jane. You're like one letter configuration off from being called Jean.
But no, yeah, so, like, fucking her telekinetic powers for 8, is which is care.
Creating illusions.
Which actually is pretty cool, because, like, her illusions, like, really, really look real.
Yeah, she could do anything from make spiders appear on your hand, to create a nice butterfly, to making a bridge collapse on someone. To make
11 almost have a nervous breakdown.
To having diarrhea leak out of a bathroom stall.
I just thought it was water.
Poo water? Did you not see the brown coloring?
No, I just saw, like, actually, it looked like soap to me. I don't know. Like, it just...
It was an illusion.
But no, like, anyways.
The illusion of choice.
So, like, 11 meets this ragtag, the C-minus team over here, fucking...
And I mean, don't get me wrong, they weren't the worst.
They weren't, it's just...
They were good in their own right, but they were mostly there just for 11 to get more character development. I mean, if their characters get some more development, I wouldn't mind them showing up at least one more time in Season 3 if it makes sense in the story plot. Like, if they show up to see what happened.
Yeah.
And, like, Kali starts to, like, bond with her more. Even if she just shows up by herself, just, like... My friends are fine. I just came to say hi to you and whatnot. Yeah.
I'm sure Carly
gets introduced to her friends.
I'm sure Carly's going to make another appearance in Season 3. Because,
like, I didn't dislike her. I actually enjoyed Carly, and I think she could... She isn't as one-dimensional as, like, the episode makes her out to be, where, oh, all these people are evil and they all need to be killed. She was, like, the dark and the light half of each other. Like, Eleven was the Mercy, and she was, like... The Merciless.
I really did kind of like that line, though. Like, say, like, you know, I won't stop you from showing your mercy, but don't you dare stunt mine. But no, so, like, in essentially, that's kind of Season 2. And honestly, I guess we go right into our final verdicts. And
yeah, I mean, between all the ups and the downs and the misordering of episodes, I'm never going to let go of the fact that Episode 7 should have been Episode 5. But I didn't dislike the episode. It was just bad timing. All the episodes had something for me. I was never uninterested. Everybody's character plots, I can't say they were all super strong, but everybody's character arcs, I think, were deserved and needed. And as much as I don't like the fact that Bob died, they needed to have an important character die in this season.
Yeah, but it had to be the one that was just introduced.
Well, it was either him or it was going to be Hopper or Steve. And as much as I like Bob, I don't want Hopper or Steve dying yet. Even though it would have worked for Hopper, because... That would have been even sadder, because Eleven hears the last message he left on the answering machine, and then he dies in the laboratory. But all in all, for me, just like with Stranger Things Season 1, I'm going to be watching it again. What's better than marathoning all of Stranger Things Season 1 every Halloween? Marathoning 17 episodes from the moment I wake up to the moment I go to sleep, to the point where it probably won't even be Halloween anymore. I had a blast watching this season, just like Season 1. And I hope that I'll have a blast watching Season 3 coming out. So, what about you, Dylan?
Season 1 still has a lot, like, it still has itself locked in my heart as, like, just a perfect series. I see the problems with it, but, like, I still love it so much. And I guess it has, a lot of that has to do is with the kids. Like, Dustin, Mike, God damn it! I'm forgetting Lucas, so sorry, and Will. When they first are introduced, like, you can already feel the chemistry from these four kids. And then when Will's gone, that chemistry doesn't leave. It only gets additioned from 11. And you continually see these actions happen. Yeah, like, there's a lot more, like, problems that happen with the bullies and shit and everything. But still, it never felt like it was taken away from that idea of the kids looking for Will. It always felt like that was the main goal. Not just from everyone's kind of side story, but from there. Their focus was on them. Season 2 has you looking at so many different side arcs that they kind of all correlate together near the end, but it feels like it was only coincidentally correlating it to it near the end. Like, it just so happens that everything I have had fit to the puzzle. Like, oh, you were doing this that comes to this? Oh, shit, we were doing this that comes to this, too. You know, it felt like they never gave me enough time to really get myself... and loved with the side plots. It felt like there was just too many happening at once, and I felt like it was just too convenient that everyone's side plot kind of, like, manifested itself to the main side plot. You know, like how the Hive Mind is, like how the Hive Mind made the tunnels. Every tunnel went on in a separate direction, but they all just came back to the actual, like, the Hive Mind, yeah, to the goal.
That's a pretty good
analogy. But I enjoyed it, so to me, Season 2 is a box office hit. I enjoyed it. I loved it, but I still feel like I love Season 1 a bit more. season one was just had a lot more things correlating with me when it came to characters, when it came to the like everything that was going on, the setting, and even though it felt big, like of course every season has to get a little bit more bigger, like they have to get bigger and better. But season one felt like it had that good promising edge of like, you know, scary, like a hint of like creepy and scary with just one Demogorgon. This one's like, oh, now let's add a bunch of smaller ones in the hive mind. And I understand why. You always have to like kind of like make yourself go up a bit. But I don't know. I guess I like the finale more from season one than I did from season two.
That's fair. Also, two things I forgot to mention, and one thing that you also forgot to mention that I want to, that I'm mentioning too, which I'm surprised we forgot about. But the first thing is, I also really like the like heavy Resident Evil vibe we got during the laboratory
scene. Oh, hell yeah.
The first time when they were navigating the lab. Like, that's how a Resident Evil movie should be. Like, the way they were doing that. Hell, even the CGI looked better than anything they ever fucking did.
Yeah, go back and watch Resident Evil fucking 2. That shit looks kind of crap.
And second, I don't know how the fuck we forgot about this, but the score and soundtrack for every part of this.
I kept wanting to bring it up, but then we'd go back into fucking, like, talking about the characters and stuff. But no, but like,
this will just be an added extra real quick so we don't harp on it too long. But long story short, I don't think there was a single song or soundtrack point that was off-putting to the mood.
No,
like,
it was
to the point
it was,
where it blended
it
in with the background so much that sometimes you didn't even know that there was actually
it
a soundtrack
was, it
going.
It wasn't it. It wasn't it at all. Like, it had its moments with its score, but then it would end up, like, randomly add those, like, 80s fucking songs in the background. I never felt that way with this season. The score was phenomenal, and it's just, it's, I would definitely buy the soundtrack on a CD just to listen to the score again by itself. It was amazing. Whoever, I gotta look up who did the score and I'll and like just give you credits. Like, that was amazing. Good shit. But yeah, so that's mine and Ziegler's review of season two Stranger Things. What is the next movie we're gonna try to see?
Probably at this point, it's either gonna be Thor Ragnarok, Justice League, or both, because they both come out in the same month.
When is that?
Thor Ragnarok comes out the same week as this recording, and Justice League, I think, comes out 2 weeks after.
Jesus Christ. Alright, well, anyways, we hope you guys have enjoyed this review. Hope it wasn't too long for you. I'm definitely cutting it down a lot. Like I said, I hope you guys enjoy it. Hope you guys continually enjoy our, like, review style. We're still going over some of the kinks.
Yep. But hopefully you guys have been enjoying us. This has been Critic in the Casual, and we'll see you guys next time.